food label secrets. Sugar. I'm going to start this video with a pop quiz. What do the following things have in common nutritionally? When comparing equal serving sizes, they all have nearly the same amount of one basic component, sugar. Take a look at the labels. One tablespoon of each item has 12 or more grams of sugar. Dress them up any way you want, they're all sugar. That doesn't matter, you may say. I eat raw sugar, or honey, or pure cane sugar, because it's natural, and that's better for me. Sorry, but if you're saying that, you're a sucker for good marketing. When you eat sugar in these basic forms, it's all absorbed and processed by your body exactly the same way. That's where the problem lies. Americans are eating more than 3 times as much sugar as they should, and it's hidden in thousands of everyday foods. Take a look at this Nutrition Facts label. See where it says percent daily value on the right? That tells you how much a serving provides. Notice, there's no number beside the sugar line. Sugar is such a politically charged issue, even the United States Department of Agriculture has avoided giving recommendations. To find out how much sugar is acceptable, we have to refer to the World Health Organization. They state that a healthy person should get no more than 6 to 10% of their total calories from sugar. That works out to between 40 and 55 grams per person eating a 2,000 calorie a day diet. Write that down. 40 to 55 grams of sugar a day if you're eating a 2,000 calorie diet. If you're eating less calories, you should take in less sugar. And if you're eating more, you can of course take in more sugar. So, how much sugar are Americans taking in daily? Do you think it's 60 grams? 90 grams? How about 120 grams? The actual number is a staggering 187 grams of sugar a day. Here's what happens when we eat a lot of sugar. On this chart, the thick gray line represents the ideal range we want our blood sugar to stay within. If you eat a meal that's lower in sugar, watch the green line. Your blood sugar stays within the proper range and you feel great. However, eat something that's high in sugar and watch the red line. If we eat foods that are high in sugar, it boosts our blood glucose, spiking it above the acceptable line. Then our bodies produce the hormone insulin to drive it down, and it crashes below the line. Now you're left feeling hungry and tired. To fix that, we eat more sugar. Our body produces more insulin, and it becomes a never-ending treadmill. Sugar, insulin, crash. More sugar, more insulin, crash. To help you choose foods that don't cause the spike and crash problem, a system called the glycemic index was developed. It ranks carbs, the sugar in foods, according to their effect on our blood glucose levels. The scale ranges from 1, or low glycemic index, to 100, the highest glycemic index. The idea is to look at the glycemic index of foods and choose only the ones that produce small fluctuations in our blood glucose levels. That's where products like, well, blue agave come in. It's marketed as a natural sweetener that's better for you. Well, sort of. The main carbohydrate source in blue agave is a complex form of fructose called inulin. Inulin is a form of fiber. So when you eat agave sweetener, you're looking at something that's very low, only a 10 or 11 on the glycemic index, because that inulin slows the absorption of the sugar. That doesn't mean you can eat all you want. It just means you won't experience the rapid crash other sweeteners would give you that don't have fiber. Unfortunately, if you're eating 2,000 calories a day, you're still only allowed 40 to 55 grams of sugar per day. A single tablespoon of blue agave has 16 grams. Blue agave is not the answer to your sugar cravings. Now, I also want to mention one very special type of sugar, high fructose corn syrup. It's been demonized as the unhealthiest sugar ever created. News organizations have worked themselves into such a frenzy about high fructose corn syrup that products are now starting to advertise that they're high fructose corn syrup free. Take a look at this syrup. Is high fructose corn syrup really such a bad thing? No. It's all hysteria and no science. When ordinary sugar breaks down in your body, it turns into half fructose and half glucose. When high fructose corn syrup breaks down in your body, it turns into about half fructose and half glucose. They're both almost exactly the same. There has been speculation it might be doing something else, but as of October 2011, not a single definitive study has been published showing high fructose corn syrup was any different than regular sugar. The thing you need to do is bring your total sugar consumption under control. I'm going to give you 5 ways to do it. Number 1, look for fiber. Look for food that's higher in fiber, 3 grams or more per serving. Foods that are higher in fiber have a slow, low, and steady effect on blood sugar and insulin levels. Remember the blue agave? It has the fiber inulin, and it isn't absorbed as rapidly into the bloodstream. When we eat complex carbohydrates, or sugar with fiber, our bodies don't have to pump as much insulin, and we can avoid the crash. Examples of complex carbohydrates include brown rice, oats, whole wheat pasta, sprouted wheat breads, and beans. Number 2, read the nutrition labels, not the front of the package. I'm going to use Quaker oatmeal as an example. This little packet of oatmeal has 13 grams of sugar in it. That's 25% of our daily allowance of sugar and only about 12% of our calories. Right beside this box in the supermarket is a box of lower sugar oatmeal. Read the label and you'll notice it has only 6 grams of sugar per packet. Fantastic! But right beside that was another box, weight control oatmeal, that has only 1 gram of sugar in it. There's something else surprising. The sugar and lower sugar versions have 3 grams of fiber per serving. That's pretty good. Remember, fiber slows down the absorption of sugar, so we don't get the spikes and crashes. But look at the weight control box. Each of those packets has 6 grams of fiber in them, twice as much. Read the nutrition label, and don't be fooled by the marketing on the front of the box. In this case, lower sugar is better, but the weight control is the best. Number 3, don't eat carbs alone. Simple carbs break down into glucose rather rapidly. Mix them with fat or protein, and it will be absorbed into the bloodstream more slowly, helping prevent sudden spikes in your insulin levels. Eat an apple, but put some peanut butter on it. Don't choose regular pasta and tomato sauce. Try whole wheat pasta, and mix it with meat sauce. Keep in mind, you may have to reduce your carbs when you combine foods. Don't simply pile on additional calories. Number 4. Learn more about spices. These will help you get over your carb withdrawal. Try wasabi or salsas. Add lemon or lime zest to salads and green vegetables. A light spray of olive oil is wonderful on morning toast in place of jelly. And number 5, don't switch from one sugar to another because switching doesn't work. Substituting honey for white sugar may make you feel better emotionally, but your body is still getting the same amount of sucrose. Remember, if you're eating a 2,000 calorie a day diet, you're allowed between 40 and 55 grams of sugar per day. In the next video, I'm going to look into the alternatives to sugar. For the complete series, visit us online at foodlabelsecrets.com. That's foodlabelsecrets.com. Thank you for watching.